Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we always have to say this one thing, how great thou art, and mean it. You've given us many things. You've given us life, you've given us salvation, and you've also given us prophecy. And as we look at the beautiful things around the world, and what's happening now, we can see that everything you do really does come true, and it is perfect. Thank you for everything you've done for us, and thank you for the fact that today we can have another chance to meet and to pray and to listen to the word of God. Amen. Okay, so let's begin. Today we close up with the last chapter of Colossians. Now, the next week onwards we'll be going to Thessalonians. And Thessalonians will be tremendous, tremendous, because Thessalonians is about the return of Jesus, about the man of sin and perdition. It's also got a lot of prophecy in it, lots of prophecy. Okay? So, let's close off Colossians, and let's see what we can learn from this 18 verses. Walk in wisdom, chapter 4, verse 1. Masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. Now, if a person has a servant, a maid, they should treat the maid with respect. It's often said that Singaporeans don't treat the maids with respect. Not just Singaporeans, a lot of people around the world, Saudis as well. And people treat hired servants, maids, as nothing, like slaves. People, masters, should treat their servants with love and care. Although they are paid to do a job, we should treat them properly and treat them with respect. Singaporeans sometimes get the maids to work downstairs in their coffee shops and everything, which is against the law. It shouldn't be done. If they're paid to look after children, they're paid to look after children. 2. Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Now, you see, we have to continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Now, the Bible makes it very clear. Okay? We got to make sure that we have to watch our utterance. We have to make sure we watch everything. We have to watch our steps. As we come to these last periods of time, and things are getting worse, we have to understand that everything we do, we have to think about it very carefully, what we're doing. We have to do it properly, and we have to do it in wisdom, and we have to do it in love. But wisdom is important, okay? 3, with all praying also for us. Now the praying is the church at Colossae, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. Now in verse 3, because he's in chains, Paul is in chains, his hands are in chains. He's saying that he was hoping that the church at Colossae will pray for them, so that he will continue to speak the mysteries of Christ and teach people. Isn't it amazing? How many people, if we are in prison for the sake of Christ, will continue steadfast in his love and say, I'm going to keep doing this? This is an example for everyone. When you face people in school, your polytechnics, private schools, or even daily lives, maybe like in the case, you know, you may come here and you may meet someone. Always remember to speak the truth to them. Be honest and have fervor for the Lord. They can't touch our souls. They can't touch our souls. Yes, they can harm us, true, but they can't touch our souls. Fear the one who can harm the soul. And you can hear the thunder outside as I'm speaking. God is speaking to people. Now, what do I mean by God is speaking? It's a sign, a sign. And you can see it starts to rain again. It's getting heavy again. Remember, you know, the weather is going to get worse. You can see parts of the world flooded. God is speaking. He's speaking to man right now. Okay? But we have to listen. 4, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. We got to speak what God puts in our mouth. Now, sometimes it's not going to work. Like, for example, I know that Kenneth and Elizabeth, tried with Muru and Elaine, but their responses are very, very shallow. And I think they're putting it in a very diplomatic way by using the word shallow. That's a very diplomatic word to use. We can also put it down in a more direct way by saying diabolical, wicked, lots of other things. But the point is, we don't worry. Remember what the Lord said to Ezekiel in Ezekiel 5. You speak to the house of Israel and they don't want to listen. Their blood is not on your hands. So their blood is not on our hands. We told Elaine and we told Mungru the truth. They cannot accept it. When the time comes, whose blood? Their blood is on their own hands. Right? So don't worry about what people say, because we know we are talking the truth. We can see it right now. And you will see what I taught you is correct, because the Holy Spirit has been my guide. And largely, because sometimes, of course, in my own imagination, I got it wrong, especially about 2009. But we got to understand that in this area, we are moving towards the direction that we are right. And you can see Bible prophecy coming through every day. Okay? Next. 5. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Now, redeeming is to gain or get back time. Use it properly. Now, do you notice they say walk in what? Wisdom. Walk in wisdom. Now, I know that most churches concentrate on this theme called love. Now, I'm not saying it's wrong. We should have love as Christians. Love for one another. Love for our enemies. And we got to love those around us. But why do people keep neglecting wisdom? Wisdom. If you look at the fools in this world, what do you find? They are foolishness, right? Psalm 51, a fool says in his heart, there is no God. All of them are what? Wicked. So without wisdom, what are they? Wicked. Wisdom is important. We got to be wise. Who is telling the truth? Who are the liars? You see, it's not that I was born smart. If I'm born smart, my mathematics wouldn't be a B in my PSLE. The point is that when we try to get closer to God, He gives us discernment, wisdom. Even an SMS, we can find a lie in it. We can find whether a person's telling the truth or whether they're not telling the truth. You get it? We can do that also. You can feel it, because the closer you get to the truth, you'll find that these people are not telling the truth. And as we enter the last days, you're going to find that most people around you are not telling the truth. They're liars. But you've got to stand away from it. What is the point of being friends with all these people and you die with them? Stand in wisdom. Have the wisdom of God. And by the way, what Ellis Schofield says, and I agree with him, the Jews only had the Old Testament. We have the whole counsel of God. We got the New Testament as well. Now, I know some of you will be questioning a lot. It's okay to question. Are we right? How do we know we are right, okay? You know why? Because what we see in the Bible is exactly what the Bible is telling. Straightforward. Remember what we saw in the Gospel of Luke, right, on Friday? If you know God, you will understand what? The Bible, what? Because that's the seed, you grow. So you know more, you grow more. And that's one of the things, one of our fruits of the Spirit is to know the Bible better and better and better and better and better. And ask yourself one question. I'm not here to bash, I'm here just to give an example, to extrapolate. Do you think all these people that we've spoken about week after week, do you think they know the truth of the Bible? No. Their knowledge of the Bible is at best shallow. Now, yesterday we saw, right, those of us who are here, some of them will tell you this. Oh, I know that Jesus is the Son of God, so I'm a Christian. Good. So do the demons know He's the Son of God? So does that mean they're Christian? You get it? How do we extrapolate meaning with that? The demons also know that Jesus is the Christ. Okay? So please try to understand this. It's nothing. If a person says, I'm a Christian because I pray to Jesus, how do they know they're praying to Jesus when they don't have the truth in their heart? And remember we saw the Gospel of Luke, right? In the truth. It says the truth. So when you come in prayer, you come to read the Bible, supplication must come in truth. If a person is going to change the whole thing, these words, for their agenda, how can they be Christian? The heart condition is something wrong. Because they don't care. understand the principle of what it is to be a Christian. A Christian is your heart condition before God. So all these people, all that we've spoken about in the past, the zealots, are they really Christian? You would have to be hard-pressed to say yes. Under what claim do they become Christian? Oh, because they enter a church. Now, if they enter a church and that makes them Christian, then how about the church at Laodicea? How about the church at what? Pergamos. Get it? Then what's wrong with that? And if everybody is saved because they're attending a church, how then would Jesus spew out those at Laodicea? It makes no sense. The entire Bible understanding is totally wrong. A person may go to a church, yes, it's true. They may enter a church downstairs, they may clap their hands, they may go up and down, jump up and down, they may sing the words, no. But these people worship me, their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Remember that statement and don't forget it. It's the heart condition. The heart of a Christian is to follow the words of God. If they don't follow this, they're liars. They're really liars. Okay? Now, let's look at 6. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. Now, this is where we fall. I think that the 6 of us have a problem with this. When we speak, we got to speak with grace. But we also need to have an answer for every man. Now, when they say it with grace, we got to understand that does not mean diplomacy. If this is the case, how explain Jesus with the Pharisees and the Sadducees? No. With grace, what you mean? You got to tell the truth, you see. You understand? You have to tell the truth to every man. Now, we know that there's a lot of wickedness, okay? You can see it. They're not truthful. At the end of the day, these people are not truthful. They're not telling the truth. And as things get worse, you know, the thunder and the lightning, and Singapore starts having more rain, and things start getting worse, you will see they'll eventually wake up. But it's too late. It's too late for them to change. Okay? In fact, I still think they won't change. You know, I have a feeling, I have this premonition, that even if you tell one of these zealots in the last days, okay, why didn't you come? Actually, I was thinking about it. Say, why didn't you come? Just to test them. Okay, why didn't you come to our service for the last 2 Sundays before Jesus returns? I will say it in front of you all. You have a feeling they will say no. I have a feeling you'll still say no. They will refuse the truth right to the land. You know what they want to do? They will, even if they see her, let's say for example, they ask, maybe let's say one of the zealots will ask, let's say Elizabeth, hey, what's going on since your church knows. They will only say just to find out what's going to go on, but not to change. No. If I were to tell them point blank, would you now repent and say, I'm going to stop going to my church for the last 14 days before Jesus comes? You know the answer will still be no. You will watch. That wicked. The heart condition is a problem. Okay, now let's look at this last verses. Greetings from believers. All my state shall Tychicus declare unto you, who is a beloved brother and a faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. Now Tychicus was to tell everything to them about what was happening with Paul. And notice what he says. I love what he says this. He says, it's a beloved brother, faithful minister. No. Now what is faithful? That means tells the truth. He sticks in faith and he's not turning to the left, to the right, telling people stories. And what? Fellow servant in the Lord. Beautiful words. Look at 8. Whom I sent unto you for the same purpose, that ye might know your estate and comfort your heart. Tychicus also wanted to know how the churches at Colossae doing, and find out and know, you know, comfort your heart. 9. With Onesimus, a faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you, they shall make known unto you all things which are done here. So Onesimus also is going to tell them what's going to happen. And you see, they're faithful in one, brother in one. Remember, to be Christians, we must be in one spirit. No? It's not like, I have my own idea. Now question, can Christians have division? To a certain extent, yes. Yes. Paul and Barnabas, they can have division. But I don't think they held it all the way to the end. I don't. And I don't think they held an agenda. They went separately, but I don't think they hate each other. There's no way they're going to hate each other. But at the end of the day, I believe that if you look at it, if you remember Paul and Barnabas, they had an issue with John Mark, and they didn't want to bring John Mark along with Paul. Do you notice that Paul eventually worked with John Mark? That means Paul yielded eventually, but he still yielded and still used John Marks as his minister as well. Do you get the point that at the end of the day, there's still unity? Still unity. Now, the question is, if we are not united with the majority, the zealots, are we the ones wrong? Someone's got to be wrong somewhere. It's either we are wrong, they are right, or they are wrong and we are right. But the question is, the Bible says the few. And how come is it if they are right, they cannot hold up the Bible and point out the same verses that we can? What is helping us? And by the way, it states in the Bible. I'm going to do this one more day for you all. It says in John 14, 15 and 16. Please read it if you don't have time. Or if you're not willing to wait for me, read it tonight. You know what it says? You know when you have the Holy Spirit, you'll understand the Bible better. Now, I'll ask you one question. I want you to condemn. If a person has a corrupted interpretation of the Bible that is so far out the truth, that means opposite, no? That means black become white become black. How can they be Christian? They may be new Christian, maybe new. That means don't know, confused. Fine. Get to Christianity, they learn. Correct? Yes. But we're talking about, let's say, a person who's been Christian for at least 1 year, claiming to read the Bible, and they can get it so far out. Okay? For example, how can a person say slain in the spirit in the Bible when they've never seen it? Now, if a person was honest, wouldn't they say, my church says it's slain in the spirit, but I haven't seen it yet? They're being honest. But when they say, I saw it somewhere, they're dishonest. Are they in the right spirit? No, the Holy Spirit's not in them. And how about the guy on YouTube? He says, I've seen it so many men, but the Bible says the secret rapture of the church. He said to me in reply on YouTube. Really? I mean, many of us have read the entire Bible, but where is it stated that Jesus is coming 2 trips, 7 years apart? It's never stated. And you know when I challenged him, he couldn't produce one verse. And he says emphatically, I've seen it everywhere. You see, these people are liars, they're not Christians. How can a person take something and get such a twisted thing and not even see that clear declaration? Now, people may claim it may be English. Okay, maybe the ancient English may be difficult. I agree. But those persons may be reading the NIV. So, and even then, they still have a problem. Okay? Try to understand. To be a Christian, we must have the true word of God. Then we know we are saved. If we got the right interpretation, that means we are on the right track. We have the Holy Spirit in us. But maybe it's not very strong because the Holy Spirit may not be so close to us because we got some lingering sin in us. And the Holy Spirit's holy. Holy Spirit's not going to hang around someone all the time who is not that holy. Get it straight. That's one reason maybe we're not that strong. Okay? Now let's go to now this 10. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner. Now we learn that Paul is in chains, probably Rome. And Aristarchus is his prisoner as well. But this isn't stated in Acts. Acts, Luke focused on who? Paul. But we know that Aristarchus is also in chains. Salute of you. But you see, even though he's in chains, he's saluting the church at Colossae. And Marcus, sister's son to Barnabas. By the way, you know this Marcus, when I typed it out, I just realized who it is. Mark. You know why? Mark is Hebrew. Marcus is Greek. Okay? Sister's son to Barnabas. Just guess who that is. Now, do you think that Paul and Barnabas were still having a disagreement? I don't believe it. Touching whom you receive commandments, if he come to you, receive him. You see, he's saying, if Mark comes to you, John Mark, receive him. Isn't it amazing? Now, do you think that Paul was still having an agenda with him? No. I don't think Paul had an agenda. Paul may have had the reasons in the first place. And there was a sharp disagreement with Barnabas. But you see now, he says, please welcome him. Christians cannot remain in loggerheads. Cannot. How come is it those keep away from us? Because they hate the truth. You understand? They hate the truth. And even what Alice Schofield said. Actually, it's a pity because some people, they did not be bothered to read the book Alice Schofield's Demons in the Church when I sent it years ago. If you read it, it would have developed them faster. If you look at verse chapter 14 of the book, it says exactly what I've been telling you all these years. And I was saying it before I read the book. So it's not I'm trying to jump onto some bandwagon and just because a man said it. It's what the Lord led me to know. You see, it's a hard condition when a person cannot believe the Bible. They cannot accept the Word of God, like Jacqueline, for example, and all those zealots. We got to understand that is what is the problem with them. And we know we are in the safe zone because we can accept truth. If we can't accept the truth, I shudder to think what we're going to do on Judgment Day. Now, 11 and Jesus, which is called justice. Okay? Justice is mentioned in Acts 10. Who are of the circumcision. Circumcision means Jews. These only are my fellow workers unto the kingdom of God, which have been a comfort unto me. Now, the other workers. I try to understand what Paul's saying. The other workers, no. But these people that he mentioned, Marcus, Justus, okay, all those, Tychicus and all that, they were the ones who were comforting him when he was in Rome, prison. By the way, if you really read it at the end, it was quite sad. There was one part where Paul was initially abandoned in his first trial. Read it, and he says, but never mind, I will not hold it against them. And he hopes that God is not going to hold it against them. Sometimes even, I tell you, even Christians can let others down. We got to stand together, okay? Now, let's look at this. 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, salute of you, okay? But you see, he's also noticed that Epaphras was one of you, a servant, right? But he didn't mention Epaphras as one of those who comforted him in Rome. You see? Also laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. You see, we have to be perfect before the will of God. We've got to do the will of God perfectly. David sinned. Yeah, he sinned. He sinned with Bathsheba. But he was forgiven. And you know something? Whoever God forgives much, they will love much. Whoever fought is forgiven little, they love little. God loves you all. Jesus loves you all. He's willing to forgive you. And you see, the way he talks about these kind of people, they pray every day, long-suffering, praying. Pray again and again. That's why we have to keep praying. Okay? By the way, I want to just clarify, as I've seen some at this point at this verse. When I told you all about praying several times a day and reading the Psalms, I'm spot on. The Bible it says we have to come together in the Psalms every day, daily. Okay, it's number one. So that didn't set you down. The idea was put into my mind suddenly. I believe it was from God's Spirit. Because it followed the Bible before I saw that verse. I mean, I've seen that verse, but subconsciously you don't remember. But I did it and I read it under the NIV, now I know it under KJV. So that was number one, right? Two, you know the didactic said we have to come together in prayer more regularly before the end. It's stated very clearly in the didactic. So I did not sell you guys down on that one as well. I told you guys the truth. So those, like for example, that time, you know, one of our former members said to Carl and his wife, why must I come so much? She can't understand that. We had to come together. People who think that this is a big sacrifice coming down all the way here miss the point. It's not such a big sacrifice to come here. I mean, people can do other things here. You know what I mean? You can do your poly work, you can do other stuff. But to come down is important. And when the time comes, we will pray every hour on the hour. During that hour of trust. Every hour on the hour. Actually, I wish we can pray more. I travel pretty far and I've got to normally do photocopy and all that, but I wouldn't mind if someone stays nearby and can open up this place, start praying at 11, then 11, 1, 3, 5, all pray. Get that continuity of prayer. And by the way, I still notice that some of you like to come late, you struggle in, because I always watch. It's a habit, because not before, it's long before I became a Christian. I like looking at my watch when latecomers come in for lectures and NTU and all that. So it's something that I notice. When we pray at 7, it means we pray at 7. It says regular times. And it's got to be specific times. God isn't going to wait. Okay? We do it at His time. If we say we're going to pray at 3, 5, 7, 9, we pray at 3, 5, 7, 9. Sometimes I'm also guilty because sometimes I do my work first. I got a teacher. Maybe I should get someone else to pray first. But we got to keep the timing. Okay? This is something we're not going to change till the end. Till everything's over. Okay? 13. For I bear Him record that He have a great zeal for you and them that are of the in Laodicea. You see, Epaphras has great deal of zeal. Laodicea, they had zeal. And them in Hierapolis. Now, Hierapolis is in Greece. Now, do you notice the Laodicean church had zeal before? Now, do you notice one thing, everyone? Laodicea, no, they had zeal before. What happened later? They lost it. Do you see how churches lose it? They did it in the first century churches. After the Reformation, they lost it again. Luke. By the way, the Luke here is the Luke of the Gospel Luke. The beloved physician and Demas greet you. Salute the brethren which are in Laodicea and Nymphas and the church which is in his house. Now notice this, ladies and gentlemen, the church is in his house. Where seven times we are mentioned, told in the New Testament that the Christians are supposed to meet somewhere. And where is always the church meeting? In the house. I really wish sometimes, because I want to follow the Lord's will 100%. If I had a big enough living room, someone had a condo or what, you know, something like this, where there's enough tables and chairs, I wouldn't mind meeting in someone's house. To tell you the truth, I prefer to do that. Because here, although it's partly correct, because I spend certain number of hours here a day, so it's kind of like my home away from home, I prefer to do it in my literal home, follow the Lord. But nowhere is it told to be in cathedrals and all, meeting where for God. It's the house of the believer. This, later you all can make a point to translate. It's the house of the believer, the home. Okay? It's not where the zealots meet, all those new creation, all those Suntec city. By the way, they're not meeting in Suntec. You know they're so rich. They can even afford convention halls. Cost about 35,000. So they meet now in these kind of places. They want the posh places. That's not where the church of God is to meet. The church of God to meet the home of a believer. Nowhere else. 16, and when this epistle is read among you, cause it to be read also to the church of Laodiceans, and that ye likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. Do you know, ladies and gentlemen, the epistles were shared among the churches. So this letter to Colossus was given to the church in Laodicea. The letter from Laodicea was given to the church in Colossus. They read it, they share it. They shared it in the first century, you know. They wanted to edify believers. But you know something, do you know what tells us something? Something is missing from the Bible. You know why? There's no letter to Laodicea in the Bible. And you know why it's not there? Here's where the shock of the millennium is going to come in. When the Bible was put together in the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD, it was the Catholic Church, partly under Constantine the Great. And then they sat down with all the bishops, all that, to decide what was the final books of the Bible. At the time, there's no Apocrypha. There's no Apocrypha. So there's 66. But while they did the right thing by dropping out those that are apostate books, like the Book of Jubilees 1, Jubilees 2, while they dropped out the so-called Gospel of Philip, they also dropped out other texts. Do you know there's belief that Peter wrote more than one epistle? And do you know that also, there's also a letter to Laodicea? There is actually more. Do you know there was actually three letters to Corinthians? One's missing, Laodicea is missing, the letter is missing. Question is, where are they? Do you know they still exist? They do. You know where? Vatican Library. The Vatican isn't allowing people to see this. Yeah, it's the Vatican. Because the Vatican is the one that's holding the text. Okay? And where they can, they try to burn it. But there is, they have found. Check it out. You can check it out online and do a Google search. There are other texts of the Bible. And this is part of the Antinician Library. Antinician Library, yes it is. And you know, the great church fathers, like Jerome, all that, many people, not Jerome, the one before Jerome, the one second century, they've actually mentioned that there were other documents. But somewhere down the line, those documents disappeared. They were kept concealed. Probably there is some other truth that was written. Maybe because of some attempt by the devil to hold back the truth, certain things were taken out. And by the way, I often wondered, why did the Bible peak at 66 books? Because that number doesn't seem to be significant. I sometimes think that maybe there's 70. Maybe they could have been Laodicean letter, maybe Peter, maybe Didaca, I don't know. There could have been some others, there should have been them. But who is ultimately the Lord. Lord's decision is not mine. So what the Lord allowed, permitted to be remain, is enough, sufficient for the Christian. But it's interesting to know. No? Now some people will say this. These books may not have been inspired. If the letter to Laodicea could be read by those in Colossae, and the letter from Colossae to those in Laodicea, then both were inspired by the Holy Spirit. Right? So that means there would have been some other things that are inspired but were kept away from people. Isn't it logical? Wisdom. So that means Paul wrote to Colossians. It can be the four chapters are here in our Bible. So the letter to Laodicea is missing because it was not inspired by the Holy Spirit. So then why were both churches to share the letters? Correct? You think about it for a while. And sometimes I often wonder about why there are 66. I think there is more. I believe that the Didache, because the Didache is the book of the apostles, but there are four gospels. We can be sure there are four gospels. How do we know? It was mentioned by Erasmus, Irenaeus, Hippolytus, all mentioned there were four gospels. Everybody. All the church leaders from the first and second century said there are four. At the end of the first century, they met. They were asked a question. It's in the Christian writings. You can read it in the Antinician library. They asked, how many gospels are there? They said there are four. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Four. That's confirmed. So the Gospel of Philip is out. That's not inspired by God. That's heretic. But what happened to the ones that were written by the apostles? By the way, if you read the Didache, you can, I don't know, maybe sometimes some of you don't want to waste time, you know, it's just not to me. I just looked a few things, you know, one day you were all inside the room, I was just looking at a few of the chapters. The Didache gives a lot of spiritual wisdom. It says, establish prayers at regular times. It says that we should fast before baptism, which is what I told you all to do. Which is not stated in the Bible, but I told you all to do that. And a lot of things that are good spiritual wisdom. So I don't think it's totally wrong. Okay, Carl says we shouldn't just ignore such things. But I think he's missing the point. If there is a letter to Laodicea that they can read, why can one be read and why can't the other be read? Why can't both be in the Bible? Logic? So that means while he was writing to the Laodicean church, suddenly the Holy Spirit is not ministering to him. It cannot make sense. But I believe certain things have been concealed. I believe there is more. And by the way, you can check it out. For those of you who got the knowledge, you just Google it. You say that early century, first century church writings, you can find it. They have a whole list of it. Go, you Google it. And it's beautiful. They've got certain things you can't find. And a lot of it is in line with the teachings of the Bible. It's not apostate. The Gospel of Philip is nonsense. That one is written by apostate. Or some heretic or what. Or some, you know. That one is very off because the Gospel of Philip. And then, by the way, there's also another Gospel of Barnabas which was written by a Muslim. Those are all wrong. Those are really far out. Totally out. They were written much later. Those aren't in the Gospels. There's even one Gospel of, no joke, Judas. Yes. But that one is not dated. The papyrus is not. It's dated much later. And it says that Jesus is laughing all the time and then the thing ends when Judas has betrayed Jesus. That was cleverly done by a heretic. So please realize that there's certain things that are not in the Bible. But what's in the Bible, we can tell. Now let's go to 17 and say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord, that thou fulfill it. Now Archippus is probably the pastor or the leader. And he says, take heed. You know why? Those in the ministry of God who do not fulfill it are going to stand standing. Okay? The salutation by the hand of me, Paul. Now Paul is the one writing this, remember my bonds, because he's in chains. Grace be with you all. Amen. Beautiful ending, isn't it? But isn't it something that we learn more about the Bible each time? I don't know what you see, sometimes I don't know what you guys really feel. But I tell you honestly, if you give me two choices, to be in New Creation Church and listen to all that fake, or to be here and listen to the truth of God's word, to me, I don't even consider that a choice. It's not even a choice. Who wants to be in that knowing life? Thinking that they are slain in the spirit and they are being energized by the Holy Spirit. But anyone sitting down, you know, like we read demons in the church about that woman who stated. They also, when she came out of Pentecostal movement, she also was fakery. So can you imagine all that, every Sunday, that deception that goes on and on and on and on and on. It's fakery. Correct? It's fakery. By the way, to close off, before we go to the prophecy, don't get too disappointed. Not many people are going to be Christians now. Okay. But the reason why I wanted to bring people was because I wanted to tell them the truth. But if they don't want to know. But I will deal with Mom Group one more time this coming week. That's all. I will deal with her. Don't all the rest of you back off. I'll deal with her. I will give her a final warning. Just I have to give a warning. Okay. Then after that her blood is on hands. Now let's go to the Revelation. Now today we're going to end this book on Revelation. We will start it again in January, 8 days of January. Because you never know, boy. You never know what's going to happen across Christmas.
Next week, I'm going to do something that I never did in the service. I'm going to do Isaiah 24. Since Shirlene's coming, probably, I want to do specifically that one. And button on the hatchets, man, you really got to get through it, because Isaiah 24 is a roller coaster, right? When you read Isaiah 24, and you know what's going to happen, you suddenly will think very different about it at times. Very different. Okay, very different. Now let's go to the pure river of life, chapter 22, verse 1. And he, Jesus, showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. What is that water of life? The Holy Spirit. Pure, clean water. Undefiled. Call it Holy Spirit. Beautiful, isn't it? If you get some of the apostate churches, they'll probably interpret this, you know, as some kind of sparkling mineral water. No, seriously, seriously. Apostate churches. You all haven't been enough. You really got to listen to what they're saying. Sit down. Roll back and roar and after. I looked at YouTube at some of the things they say about the end times. And the interpretation of Revelation. If it's not for the tragedy of the amount of people that are deceiving, I think I would be down on the floor laughing, because some of it is really foul. You know, some of it is really stupid. Stupid. Probably all those jokers will probably say it's some kind of parody, because those guys never take it seriously. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded the fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Isn't that beautiful? The nations will be healed in the afterlife. By the way, it does not come immediately. This is going to be a shock to some of you. It doesn't mean when Jesus comes suddenly everything, there's still healing of the nations, there's going to be a lot of hurt. No. People haven't forgotten, because as you go through Judgment Day, a lot of people will be recalling something. Let's say John Hooper, okay? He goes on there. His soul comes in and the Lord says, you're in heaven. What the people did to him, there's still a need for healing. So there is the tree for healing. Okay? And notice there's 12 fruit. 12. Now ask yourself, what fruit is this? Fruits of the Spirit. Fruits of the Spirit. Perseverance, right? Patience. Long suffering. Okay, love. See? The fruits of the Spirit. So this is the healing of the nations. Isn't it beautiful? And by the way, you know the tree of life, right? You know something where the tree of life is mentioned? The tree of life is mentioned at the beginning of the Bible. Beginning. And you know what's the best part? The tree of life, Adam and Eve had a chance with the tree of life. They didn't take it. They chose the tree of knowledge. Remember when Jesus said, ensure they cannot take the tree of life, otherwise they'll be immortal. They'll be like us. So what happens? Like this? Okay, then they allow, see, God permits, but still God controls Satan. Satan went for the tree of knowledge. Satan's a nandu. But the point is that he got them to eat the tree of knowledge. Can you imagine they ate the tree of life? You saw how God did it. So God ensured he still was in control. Someone claimed, now I read this Christian book. Now it was meaning in a good way. Okay. This Christian is a zealot, but he is really trying to defend God. But he says, God lost to Satan in the first round at Eden. I disagree. God will never lose to Satan. He says, no, but he says that God will win at the end, which is true. That part is true. But the first part, no, God didn't lose. God ensured Adam and Eve didn't eat the tree of life. They ate the tree of the knowledge of, okay, of good and evil. Isn't it interesting? Which one was chosen? Okay? And three, and there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. Got it? The servants will serve him every day. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. You know, this is beautiful. You will get to see the Lord God the Father face to face. And you'll get to see Jesus face to face, your brother. And you know what's the best part? No more curse. And by the way, for some of you, right, that day some of you are smiling, you don't understand that these are actually curses. You do not know that these are curses. Like some of you may have been brought to a temple when you were young. You do not know that that's actually a curse. Some of us may have been cursed, but we do not know that there's a curse hanging on us and we haven't cleared it yet. So while we may still be Christians, we've still got a curse hanging on to us. There is such things as curses. I wasn't talking rubbish. There is a curse. We've got to get that curses out of ourselves. We've got to make sure. Now, I'm not saying we're not saved. Right? You may still have a curse till the day you die and still be saved. But some people pronounce curses on people. They curse others. We got to clear ourselves off of that. Okay? I mean, I'm not saying if we will clear the curse, we'll enter heaven. No. It simply means that we got to ask for the protection of the Lamb. That's basically it. Now, this is the thing. And by the way, the name of the Father shall be on the foreheads. Foreheads. Okay? I believe it's the tetragrammaton, one of the name of God. And this is goes back to the forehead, the mark of the beast, a spiritual mark. It's a spiritual mark. It does not mean that, you know, of course, those the mark of the beast claim that they're going to put a computer chip. When I was younger, before the computer chip came out, they said, no, they do, they're going to brand them, like, you know, chop, chop, like that, no, the 666 here. I'm not joking. That's what they did. When I was younger, I read this book. That was before the computer chip came out, before. So they switched, you see, dispensation switched the argument. Before they claim that everybody will be forced down, and then they will chop them brand X, no, chick, like that, no, with the 666. No joke. You look at the interpretation of the Bible. And you know something, these people claim they are so right now. Yet, very easy to defeat them. If they were right in the first place, why did they change the interpretation in the second place? And remember now, and before the mark of the beast, some of them long ago, the Catholic Church came out, the mark of the beast was different. So try to understand that. They're not clear in their teaching. Now, whether you go to FCBC or whether it's schools, you'll find they all contradict each other. Even them, even among dispensationalists, they contradict each other. Okay? Then Seventh-day Adventists said the mark of the beast is Sunday service. Even better still. Now look at number 5. And there shall be no night there, and they need no candle. Now candle is what? Gospel light. Neither light from the sun. Gospel light. For the Lord given them light, and they shall reign forever and ever in eternity. Beautiful, right? 6. And he said to me, these sayings are faithful and true. The Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto us servants the things which must shortly be done. Shortly be done. And dispensation is clear that from the time Revelation was given, the whole book of Revelation remains dormant until the last 7 years. Beautiful interpretation they got. Actually, when you look at it clearly in the Bible, the clear words don't fit what they say. Okay? And they say, by the way, the angel of the Lord is Jesus. But I think when the people who translated this are the KJV people, they didn't realize it's Jesus talking. That's why I noticed it's not in red. It's Jesus talking, actually. The angel of the Lord signifies who's the angel of the Lord. It's Jesus. Okay? By the way, the angel here is meaning what? Messenger. Now, I want to show you this, verse 7. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. Now, some people interpreted it even wrong. You know, they said, okay, they have good intention. Now, these are the so-called good Christians, but they sometimes misinterpret it. They say that you must keep the sayings of the whole Bible wrong. It says the sayings of the prophecy of this book. It's not the Bible, you know. It's Revelation specifically. Now, do you know why Satan wanted people to come away from Revelation? Because it reveals too much. That's why it's called Revelation. Now, remember what the woman from Bakra and Sayur Saji said, oh, never mind, just be a Christian, don't follow. You can see they tried to take us away from this. That's why Jacqueline has been fighting tooth and nail for 8 years to get me away from this. Not knowing, she's not doing the will of the Father. No. Whose will is she doing? Satan's. And you see what it says here. Behold, blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. You see, it's a blessing. It's a blessing to each one of you. No? Are you clear? So don't deviate. It's a blessing to you. No? Not to me, no, to you. To all of us who follow the book of the Revelation. It's a blessing. And by the way, as I told this to Godfrey about 8 years ago, it is true. Every book in the Bible is a blessing. True. But only in Revelation is it explicitly said twice. It's said in Revelation 1 to verse 3, and it's now said Revelation 22:7. It says, blessed are those who keep the sayings of the prophecy of this book. You know what it means? It's a specific blessing. And the blessing is what? The blessing is that you are really, I'm a really disbeliever. I mean, this is what I'm sharing with you. You will never hear it from others like Paul Walsh or Tim Boyle. This is I'm going to tell you today. I honestly believe that people who can interpret Revelation have gone to another level. I really do believe that. Because I noticed that the very strongest people who interpret the Bible, like Matthew Henry, he's the one that identified, I give you a day for a year. So did Isaac Newton. So did Tillman von Bach. So did Martin Luther. So the people who seem to know the Bible the best also have a very good interpretation of Revelation. Notice that I really believe that knowing Revelation unravels a lot of things. I told this to Kenneth Elizabeth many years ago. Alice Schofield is right, and I agree with him. People read the whole Bible trying to understand Revelation. He says wrong, they're looking at it the wrong way. Read Revelation, you understand the Bible better. I found it's true. You know, after I finished, by the way, I never told you all the story of how I did it. I carried this story before we end. In 2007, April, I think it's April the 6th. It's either the 6th or 10th. But I know that at that time I was reading two chapters a day. I think so, it probably would be April the 6th. When I reached Genesis chapter 10, Table of Nations, I remember this day. I remember it's April, but I can't remember the exact day. I read Genesis chapter 10. Now, I finished in March. I finished what book? Revelation. Okay? I finished Revelation in March. So I finished. Then a few days I had not read my Bible because I wanted to start on the 1st of April exactly the new the Bible again because I was thinking on April, March 26th or March 28th, something like this. So I said I'm going to start the first and start it again, the new cycle. So on this day when I checked it out, suddenly when I read it, now remember I had never had this idea before, never. I read Revelation and I loved it and I was reading it. Suddenly when I came to this day, I read the 6th of the 10th, this is the 6th. And then I read Genesis chapter 10. Straight away, the false prophet is Muhammad. Straight away I got that answer, straight away. And I've never read any book or anything that said it before then, never. I went up, spoke to Godfrey. He was in his car, I said, yeah, maybe you're right. Shortly later, he found the book False Prophet on Jerusalem Post. And then he sent me the link. Oh no, tell me the link or something like this. He told me how to get it. And then I found, shortly later, the link beholdthebeast.com. And then gave me the confirmation. Now ask yourself, why? Why suddenly? Because I already read this about 2-3 times and it became clearer. It became clearer. So when you read Revelation, everything in the Bible becomes very clear to you. You clear? Are you all clear about that? That's why those who say that Revelation is not important are deceiving themselves by checking. They don't have their blessing. And you know what? What happens when you don't have a blessing? You have a curse on you. It's a curse. Why? Because if you're not being blessed by knowing all this, it's going to be a curse by not knowing it. Okay? Now 8, and I, John, saw these things and heard them. And when I heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things. Now if the angel was not Jesus, why would he be worshipping the angel? So the angel was who? Jesus was. Okay? Then said he to me, see thou, do it not, for I am thy fellow servant, because Jesus is working with them. Again, and of thy brethren, the prophets, and of them that keep the sayings of this book. Notice this, sayings of this book. I think John MacArthur thought that this book means the Bible wrong. The sayings of who? The book of Revelation. Of this book, no, he's referring to this book. No. Okay? Because he says, it's talking about this book. And his prophecy. Now, go back to Revelation 1, chapter 19. 119 or 4:1, and it says worship God. So Jesus is pointing to the Father, and he says this, he saith unto me, seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. Now time is at hand, so don't seal it. How about the dispensationalists? They say it's in the last 7 years. The time is at hand. It's at hand means it's now. Okay, you see, he that is unjust, now look at 11 is very important. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. You see, in other words, right, those that are holy will remain holy till the time Jesus comes and comes to heaven with him. Those that remain unrighteous will die in the lake of fire. And they will remain that way all the way. So trying to change people in this last hour isn't going to help. Now 12. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me. Now I know people.